ladies and gentlemen, please welcome founder and chairman, the New York Forum Institute, Richard Attias.
Bonjour. Je sais que l'après-midi est longue.
I know that this is a long afternoon.
Mais il y a beaucoup de choses que l'on souhaite partager avec vous.
Many things that we wish to share with you.
Donc, je vous remercie d'être présent.
So I would like to thank you all for being here.
Il y en aura encore plus dans les.
And there will be
dans l'heure qui suit.
More to share in the next
des belles
hour.
Annonces.
Happy announcements.
Mais
closing
je voulais
speech.
Absolument partager avec vous.
But I wanted
quelque chose qui m'a personnellement impressionné cette année, en
2015.
J'ai eu le privilège de contribuer à organiser un forum
to the organization
à Sharm el-Sheikh en Égypte.
Of a forum at Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt.
En soi une civilisation
and this country that in itself is a civilization. Is a major African champion. And so for this session, I would like you to welcome on stage Her Excellency Naglaa EL EHWANY, Minister for International Cooperation in Egypt, with His Excellency Ambassador of Egypt in Libreville, Gabon, also accompanied by Ibrahim MABROUK, representing the group Arab Contractors, and Dr. Osama Abdel, who is the head of the Memphis company for the pharmaceutical and chemical industry. Please welcome them warmly.
La session va être en anglais, mais je
the session will be in English, but I will kick it off to make sure that everyone understands this announcement in French, because Mrs. Minister speaks French. Your Excellency, there is nothing due to randomness.
El Maktoub,
as we say. Exactly 5 minutes ago,
Google.
I had an
Egypte.
Alert on my phone. Google.
Du plus grand
Egypt.
De gaz
discovery of the largest gas mine in the Mediterranean.
Dont le
Eni, the energy producer whose managing director was with us, has just announced the largest natural gas site in the Mediterranean, giving you a total autonomy and energetic independence for years and decades to come. So, Mabrouk, Mabrouk, Mabrouk.
Voilà. Mille merci pour ce nouvelle.
Thank you very much for this announcement. I am, of course, delighted. But this is an issue because this means I will have to continue to come to Gabon to hear such good news every year. And Gabon will have brought you luck.
Your Excellency, the late Nelson Mandela said one day that Africa, the African continent, will never get ahead unless South Africa and Egypt are in complete agreement. And Egypt has been seen for a long time as an Arab country and not really an African country, to be honest. What do you think about this notion?
Well, what I could say that we have in Egypt this complexity. And I think that this is mainly due to the geographic location of Egypt and its long history. Egypt is an Arab country. But Egypt is an African country also. And it is a Mediterranean country, as well as an Islamic country and a Middle Eastern country. So as you can see, there is a complexity of all those. But I don't see this as a weak point or a negative point. On the contrary, this is a positive point, because this is exactly what gives Egypt the potential to be a real bridge between Africa and the whole world. We are in Egypt a multicultural society. We accept others, we understand others, and we accept the diversity of everyone. So as I'm saying, this is a positive and good point to us. And remember, Richard, that when we attended the opening ceremony of the Suez Canal, we said that this is the gift of Egypt to the world, in the sense that all the world will benefit from it, and I'm sure that the African continent especially will benefit more. And I will add something also, that last March, by the end of March, Egypt hosted a big conference for the three economic blocks of Africa for a free trade area. So this assures you that we are Arab and we are African and we have our African origin.
I have no doubt. I think we have the same roots. If you allow me, Your Excellency, I think before talking about the economy of a country, it's important to understand also the global politics and the roadmap. Yeah. So I would ask His Excellency, the Ambassador Fati, to maybe in few minutes remind to our friends what is today really the political roadmap and in which perspective we have to position Egypt.
Thank you very much. Well, I'll try to put it in very brief sentences, as we had a long and very dense transitional period. And we had two revolutions. We had lots of changes, deep changes socially, politically, and in all the sectors. Starting from 3rd of July 2013, we had a roadmap to complete our transition towards a newly democratic state. It was composed from three main points. First of all, a new constitution, and this has already been done. We took examples from all the modern constitutions concerning right of the family, rights of the woman, right of the disabled persons, even some of the powers delegated to the president was shared with the parliament and the prime minister. This constitution was approved in a national referendum in January 2014 by a majority of 96% of the participants. The second stage was the presidential elections, and this was done in May, end of May. Also, it was recorded a very high percentage of participation, 47%. The president, current president, Mr. Abdel Fattah Sisi, he won by a majority of 97%, which is 25 million votes. Now we are waiting for the implementation of the third phase, which is the parliamentary elections. This should take place before the end of the year. The reason why it is a little bit late, because we had to amend the electoral law, so it coincides with the situation today on the ground. This is for the political part. Another important file that it should be mentioned, the security file.
Crucial, it's very crucial.
Yeah, because I think everybody sees in the news that we have terrorism, we have problems every day. The fact is, at the beginning, we had a security problem. For the time being, after a series of continuous procedures against this issue, I can say that we have areas completely safe, especially touristic areas, Red Sea, Aswan, the main destinations. Most of the areas, of course, in Cairo and the suburbs. We still have some problems. This I cannot say no. We still have some incidents, but if you compare it with a year ago, it would be minor. The issue is, if you go now for a tourist visit, 4 days in Hurghada, for instance, with a family, it's for $600, completely safe. So this is one of the issues. The third thing I would like to elaborate, completing what Her Excellency has said, concerning our policy towards African continent. We were always an African state, and we were acting like it. maybe during the last 10 years, there was some kind of, let's say, not neglect, but it came within the state of the country as a whole. Now, with the new government, there is a new policy, a new strategy. For reopening towards Africa, we have a ministerial committee within the government composed of 14 ministers. They have regular meetings on how to develop our relations with Africa. Our president was the first one. He made around 5 presidential visits to African countries, our prime minister, 7 presidential visits, and our minister, one every other week, he's in a visit in Africa. So, and the fact is that Her Excellency is here now. This is one of the proofs about this issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador. And indeed, I insisted to moderate that session personally because, as Her Excellency said, really in March, my team and I, we had the privilege to spend 6 months under Her Excellency leadership, who was asked by President El-Sisi to organize the Sharm el-Sheikh conference. And I will tell you a short anecdote, if you allow me, Your Excellency. When we met for the first time, I asked you in your offices, Your Excellency, you will be happy if, inshallah, in March, on the 23rd, how many participants will come and how many billions you will raise for investment. Yeah. You told me, I would be happy if we have 800, and if we raise 2-3 billion, it's fine. At the end of the day, 3,400 participants came. We were even closing the registration, and the country has raised 62 billion of investment. So you should really watch Egypt, and you should really go and invest in Egypt, really, frankly speaking.
Thank you.
And this is why, Your Excellency, I would like you to share with us what is the economic outlook, because during the conference, you have presented so many opportunities in several sectors. So we'd be happy to hear from you what is the economic outlook today for Egypt.
Well, let me first thank you very much, Richard, for your efforts.
My passion for your country, my passion.
Because I have to confess that without your work and your effort in this conference, it wouldn't have been so successful. This I have to admit.
Thank you.
I will come back again to the conference, but answering your question about what's going on now in Egypt and what we are doing in Egypt for the time being. Let me go back a little bit, a few years ago, prior to 2011. The 3 years that were before 2011, the Egyptian economy was witnessing high growth rates, ranging between 7-8%, but unfortunately without social justice. And at the same time when the growth rates were high, unemployment was surging and poverty rates were increased. With the revolution 2011 and the difficulties we had after the revolution, the situation deteriorated much more. And when we reach June 30, 2013, the Egyptian economy was in a very difficult position. Fortunately enough, after 4 years now of having this economic, political, and social hardships, I can assure you that we are on the right track, that we are on the recovery path, and that we are doing very well. The government of Egypt has really formulated a clear vision of the future of the country during the coming 5 years. And plans have been set to achieve a specific model for growth and development that we would like to have for our country. This model is the model of the inclusive growth, of the labor-intensive,
it's very
sustainable,
important,
yes, inclusive.
About the youth of Egypt, how to include them.
We have to include all the segments of the society, no exclusion for anyone, and especially the poor and the disadvantaged groups. And the main basic for this model is also to encourage the private sector. It has to be a private sector-led growth.
We will see that in a minute exactly. With our representative from private sector.
So this model is based on some pillars. Allow me to elaborate a little bit on this. I don't want to be too long.
No, but it's important to understand the global...
Well, the first pillar of the vision of the government and its plan is to articulate a fiscal consolidation program, which aims at reducing the budget deficit and the public debt. And the main objective of this is to give some fiscal breathing space so that you can redirect the expenditures on subsidies and else to other areas such as education, higher education, training, scientific research, and social solidarity, and all other sectors that would drive us to the inclusive growth. So this is the first pillar, the fiscal consolidation. The second pillar is to boost growth and job creation through a set of national mega projects and boosting the SMEs in the country. Another pillar which is related directly to the second
one. And the Suez Canal is one of them, no?
The Suez Canal would come in the pillar I'm mentioning now, which is the development of a whole network of infrastructure and logistics in the country and a whole program of national mega projects. This includes the Suez Canal, which has been officially opened in the 6th of August, but not only digging the canal, but we have now the next stage would be the development of the whole region of the Suez Canal with its three well-known cities, Ismailia, Bursaid, and Suez. In addition to the Suez Canal region, we have a very national projects in the northwest coast, in Upper Egypt, what we call the Golden Triangle, with wealth of minerals, and also the reclamation of 4 million faddans in 11 governorates, in addition to the repairing of more than 3,500 kilometers of roads. So this is a package of national mega projects that we intend to implement through the coming years. Another pillar, which I think that you will agree with me that this is a key pillar, is the bold reforms that are undertaken in many sectors, especially in the energy sector. Too many measures have been undertaken to reform the energy sector. On top of it, the cutting down of the subsidies, which were eroding a quarter of our state budget, they have been cut down by 30%, and the aim is to phase out the subsidies of energy in the coming 5 years. Also, we are diversifying the energy mix in the country so that by the year 2020, we would have a percentage of traditional sources of energy, 80% versus 20% sources from renewable. We have issued also an important mining law, which would tap on the wealth of minerals unexploited and undervalued in the country. We have also issued an electricity law, which would liberalize the production, the distribution, and the transmission of electricity in Egypt. We are encouraging the private sector to be engaged in the energy sector, to build stations, to produce electricity, and to buy it to the government with an attractive feed-in tariff system. So all those measures have been taken in the energy sector, and reforms have been also in other sectors.
And when this reform will be really implemented?
They are already, yes, they are already undertaken and implemented. One pillar which I think is very important in the government vision and plan is the social protection. Because as I said, we want to have an inclusive growth, a labor-intensive growth, a growth that would benefit all people, especially the poor and the vulnerable groups. That's why we have been formulating a package of programs geared toward the poor and the vulnerable groups. To name some of those programs, we are having now a conditional cash transfers program, building affordable housing units to the poor, a better distribution system for bread and food and stuff, foodstuff, and also extending the coverage of the health insurance to the poor and the vulnerable groups. So social protection is a key pillar in our work. Among all those pillars which I mentioned, I think that the critical pillar would be how to articulate a program that would create the enabling investment environment in the country. We aim at having a fair, attractive, competitive, and internationally rewarding system of incentives of investment business in the country. And in this respect, we have already done some reforms and steps which are crucial to create an investment, a friendly investment, business investment in the country. Let me tell you that during the last year, too many legislations related to investment have been amended and issued, like the investment law, the competition law, the anti-corruption law. Too many laws have been issued. So that we will cut the red tape, we will streamline the procedures, and to have a friendly business environment. The government also has succeeded in solving too many disputes with investors that have been lasting for many years. And also we are promoting investment through different missions to all countries, and as you know quite well, through the Sharm el-Sheikh conference, where we succeeded in, as you said, having very good results. I would like to end by saying something very important. We do believe in Egypt that investment is the only way to boost growth and to create jobs. Aid will not last forever. And grants do not build an economy and do not build a sustainable development. That's why we are encouraging investment, either by attracting foreign direct investment to the country or to encourage Egyptian investors to invest in other continents. And for sure that Africa, with its growing economy in the last few years, and with its untapped and unexploited resources, would be a top priority for Egypt for investment. And maybe that's why our delegation here, we have with us some of the leading people in different sectors.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you for this excellent presentation. Yes, she really deserves a round of applause because it's so well articulated. Let's talk about two great sectors. We have a great representative from the pharma industry, the pharmaceutical world, and then the construction. So maybe we will ask Dr. Osama Abdel Sattar to first maybe make a short presentation, please, about the pharmaceutical industry and what can be done maybe in partnership between Egypt and Africa, I would say sub-Saharan country, even Egypt and Gabon, because we spoke a few minutes ago about some potentialities of very concrete partnership between Egypt and Gabon.
Thank you. Thank you. Africa is in our heart, in our mind. Egypt open heart, mind, and arms for Africa. Egypt, the Egyptian pharmaceutical industry is considered one of the oldest strategic industries in Egypt. It goes back to 1939. Pharmaceutical companies in Egypt fall into three categories: public sectors, which are subsidiaries of the drug holding companies, local private sector companies, and the multinational cooperation. Egypt is an attractive commercial opportunity for multinational pharmaceutical companies, where several companies operate in Egypt, such as Boehringer, Schering, Abbott, Ohm, Bayer, MSD, Novartis, Aventis, and others. Egypt has a total number of 137 pharmaceutical factories, in addition to about 50 factories under construction. Factories in Egypt are implementing GMP as well as international standards. Therefore, our products are of very high quality, activity, and safety. The medical sector export amounted $156 million in April 2015, compared to $172 million during the same period in 2013. While Egyptian pharmaceutical exports to Africa amounted to $300 million in 2014. Africa is considered one of the main markets for Egypt to export pharmaceutical products. This is due to economic blocks and agreements that could enhance the trade within the countries. Egypt has great potential and opportunity to increase its pharmaceutical and medical products exports to Africa market. Therefore, we are looking to increase the cooperation between Egypt and our continent, Africa, especially in pharmaceutical sector. Holdi Pharma is a pharmaceutical company. It was founded in 1992. It manufactures, distributes, and markets pharmaceutical and medical products in Middle East and Africa. The company has a variety of products that can meet the need of the local and international markets. The company exports its product to many countries, such as Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Kuwait, Qatar, Jordan, Palestine, Myanmar, Georgia, Sudan, Ethiopia, Uganda, Libya, Mali, Senegal, Zambia, Cote d'Ivoire, Namibia, Mauritius, Germany, Romania, Spain, and Holland. We are coming to explore business and identify target markets, and we are willing to tailor our offering accordingly. We are focusing on forging local partnership and addressing supply and distribution challenges. We are targeting the cooperation with our African countries in the following fields. Registration of Egyptian medicine in Africa. Build pharmaceutical factories according to GMP and international standards. Transfer of know-how in pharmaceutical industry. Build pharmaceutical stores in Africa. Provision of staff training in the following items: production of different pharmaceutical dosage forms, quality control and quality assurance, research and development, production planning, internal and external audit. Moreover, we can cooperate in implementation of pharmacovigilance. Finally, devolving in pharmaceutical industry on the continent would contribute to removing financial barriers to medicines and improving access to essential medicines. Thank you for your kind attention and best wishes to our continent, Africa.
Thank you, Dr. Osama. I hope that next time you will add Gabon on your list, huh? Inshallah. Engineer, Engineer Ibrahim, you represent a company which each time I go to many countries in Africa, when we have big projects, and not only in Africa, I see always Arab constructors. Can you please, in few minutes, because really the time is over, I'm very frustrated, but I would like really, we need to keep time because we have the closing speech coming soon. Can you tell us really the magnitude of the work of Arab constructors in Africa, and maybe how we can, thanks to your efforts, have your work becoming really a South-South cooperation, and how you make it as an engineer building bridges between all African countries and between all the South-South, I would say, region.
Thank you for you. Thank you to give me the chance to speak about my company as Arab Contractor. Arab Contractor is one company leading in Africa and the Middle East. We cover 30 countries out of Egypt through 21 countries in Africa. That is Arab Contractor in Africa.
So what is half of Africa?
Yeah. This is Arab Contractor Africa. long time we are in Africa, since 25 years ago, we work in Africa. By a few words, we are our target in our investment in Africa, $3 million. This is our project in Africa. Our turnover by years is something like $500 million. Our employer in Arab Contractor, 77,000 employer, all Arab Contractor, specialized in Africa. We have something like 10,000 employer, national employer in Africa. That is Arab Contractor. When we come in the countries in Africa, we work with the national people from the countries. That is to transfer the technology, to training them how to work for the construction projects. Arab Contractor, our project in Arab Contractor, something like in building road infrastructure, water project, sewage project, hospital, airport building, all the buildings.
What are the main projects that you have now in Africa?
We have a lot of projects. We just finished one project. It's very important in Cote d'Ivoire, Abidjan. One bridge is big. Excellence Hassan Ouattara negotiated it with the...
The Konan Bedié Bridge?
This
oh, wow. Jacques it was just bridge. Opened a few weeks ago.
Yeah, this is a few years ago. It's finished, I think, last month. And we have one important route that what we make relation between Cairo and Cape Town in Ethiopia, two routes, something like 190 kilometers in Addis Ababa. That Arab Contractor, we're ready to finish one 95 kilometer from this route in Addis Ababa. This month, inshallah. This is Arab Contractor. We have a lot of projects in something like in Nigeria. We build on construction, building Ministry of War. This is $108 million approximately. Nigeria construction, Oweri, Rud, in Equatorial Guinea, the neighbor for Gabon. Alazo Kakasi, $120 million. Alange Makobi, $90 million, Biku Rud, $41 million, Ethiopian Agrimariam Yabelo Yerud, and Ethiopia also Yabachi Agrimen Yerud.
So we understand that you have really, you have a little experience in Africa.
A lot of projects in Africa.
Thank you so much. And when you lead Arab Constructors, and when you are the chairman of Arab Constructors, you can become the prime minister of Egypt, because Engineer Mahlam now is the prime minister of Egypt.
Yes, it's ready.
Your Excellency, the last word. I have a question which has nothing to do with the economy. This forum is about youth. And it was really dedicated to the youth, which I hope are still here. Est-ce que la jeunesse est encore là ou elle est dimanche?
Now, is the youth still with us? Yes. Well, I'm going to ask you the question in French. What must we do so that the young Egyptian generation, which I know is very dynamic, be much more connected and linked to their brothers and sisters in Africa? We know that Egypt is facing a complex situation, which is at the same time, which is turned towards all directions, part of Africa, gate to Africa, but at the same time, a gateway between the East and West. So how can we have a better synergy? I think the only answer is education. This is the only means to group young people of different continents together. As you know, I started as a professor at university. I was teaching economy at Cairo University. Well, you're very modest. You're a great economist. I had the opportunity also to manage a European study center at the University of Cairo. Each year, I would go to different countries in Europe and Africa, and I would take with me some students from our university. So I truly believe that the only means to regroup this youth of Africa is education through or via, trying to find my word in French. Through scholarships and exchange programs for students. So then they can see and discover that they have a lot in common. And when they then go to these countries, they learn a lot. So I say it again, education, education, and education is the only way to link the education. Well, I live that. Just one remark. I mean, please think about the visas coming from Morocco. Well, you know, an Egyptian, aren't you? You can come anytime you wish. Thank you very much, Mrs. Minister. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, and thank you, Mr. Engineer and Doctor.
Join back. On va retourner dans la salle et on passe la main à une grande session sur le leadership avant d'entendre les discours de clôture. Merci infiniment pour votre.
We will now move to the closing speeches.